Today we are starting on 24th lecture on active filters. Let us therefore consider what we had done so far. We had in the earlier lecture discussed about passive filters, RC and RL combination of low pass filters, first order filters these are called. And then we had seen the second order filter RC, RL, second order filters. These result in cascading of just first order filters which have Q less than half always. So, they are just having the poles always on the negative real axis of the S plane. So, Q is always less than half. That is the characteristic of a passive RC or RL second order filter. Therefore, if we want to realize higher Q filters, it is only possible with the help of passive RLC filter. It can give you Q of any value, okay, low or high. Low pass RLC Butterworth design, filter design, Chebyshev filter design, inverse Chebyshev filter design, all these and elliptic filter design, all these can be carried out with the help of only passive RLC blocks. We had also discussed about frequency transformation, that is an important topic. As a means of converting the respective filters like high pass filter or band pass filter or band stop filter to the low pass prototype and carrying out the filter design using frequency transformation. And frequency transformation involves conversion of S normalized frequency to 1 over S. And that is low pass to high pass transformation. We had also done low pass to band pass transformation, then low pass to band stop . So all these transformations therefore help us in doing the filter design all in the domain of low pass, okay, and shifting it to the center frequency from 0 to the resonant frequency in the case of band pass, okay, resonant frequency in the case of band stop, but the transformation is S to 1 over S plus 1 over S. So, these involve replacing inductor with series resonance at the frequency to be shifted, capacitor with parallel resonance, okay, at the frequency to be shifted as far as low pass to band pass is concerned, and the other way about, okay, in the case of low pass to band stop. Next, we are today discussing how to convert these passive filters to active filters, active RC filters. We would call them active RC filters because inductor is an element which is very bulky as far as low frequency signal processing of most of our baseband signal is concerned. The inductor becomes too bulky compared to other components. Therefore, is it possible to reduce the bulk? That is the primary reason active RC filters started emerging as a means of making the components compatible with the day's technology in electronics. So, limitations of passive filter is mainly That passive RC filter on the other hand can be only used for Q less than half, and therefore there is a need for converting the Q of a second order passive RC filter from Q less than half to Q any value positive. So, active element along with RC can achieve this by one technique called inductor simulation. That means every inductor in our RLC network is going to be replaced by a simulated inductor. That is the technique. So, all our previous designs of passive RLC filter can be directly converted to this kind of active RC filters with inductor simulation. The problem of large size inductor therefore can be resolved this way, that L is going to be L by R, this is a time constant in dimension, is same as RC time constant. That means L dimensionally can be obtained by using a capacitor and two resistors. Theoretically, this is the thing, dimensionally 1 Henry inductor can be simulated theoretically by using 1 farad capacitor and 1 ohm resistor. So, this is what the dimensional equivalence tells us. So, let us therefore see whether it is possible to do this, okay, by inductor simulation technique. Now, Q enhancement by feedback, okay, this is the other technique that we are going to talk about. This is mainly going to cover most of the Salen and Key filters that were available in the early presentation of active RC filters. Q of passive second order RC filter can be enhanced by using feedback and amplification. Then the same time analog computers were using for second nth order differential equation simulation, integrators and summing amplifiers for simulation of these differential equations. Simulation of differential equation is mathematically equivalent to designing filters. This is what we are going to see to, later. A simulator of a second order differential equation is popularly known as biquad circuit. So, we will see the third method, which is one of the most popular methods of today's IC design of filters, analog filters. The traditional approach to filter design through Q enhancement and inductor simulation are increasingly replaced today by the biquad method because of commercial availability of the universally active filter blocks UAF42 and UF10. UF10 is a switched capacitor biquad. We will see all these basic filter ICs also later in the course. Active filters by inductor simulation is the topic of today's lecture. All filters used in baseband applications, particularly in telephony, require large valued inductances resulting in large sizes. If you have to use RLC filters, that means if it is RLC filter that is used in baseband, that is voice telephone sort of speech filters, then the inductor will be too large. These filters need to be designed as active filters simulating large inductances using active devices and RC components. Let us see how one can methodically understand the synthesis of these inductor simulators. There is a popular theorem which I would say normally one should present in a network course. This is called Miller's theorem. A voltage amplifier with gain G having an impedance Z connected between its input terminal and output terminal results in at the input, as far as the voltage that is driving the amplifier is concerned, that input will see an impedance Vi minus G times Vi by Z. That is the input current. So II by VI is 1 over Zin, the input impedance seen as a grounded impedance. And what is it equal to? It is equal to this Z, the impedance connected between input and output, divided by 1 minus G. G is the transfer function of the voltage control voltage source. So this is what in a sense the Miller's theorem is. It appears as a different impedance, okay. If you start with Z, it becomes Z by 1 minus G. This is what the Miller's theorem says. So let us see how simulation of inductance in series with resistance can be done. It is not that we require an ideal inductor to be simulated. We may sometimes use inductor with a certain Q, okay. That means a series resistance or a parallel resistance. So when the series resistance is 0 or when the parallel resistance is infinity, the inductance is said to have high Q, Q equal to infinity. The Q of an inductor, Q of an inductor is equal to the comparison of the inductive reactance with the series resistance. How big this inductor is in its impedance compared to the series resistance, or okay, it is going to be the parallel resistance divided by the inductor. So that is defined as the Q of an inductor. Parallel. So actually R parallel can be shown to be Q squared roughly into R series. This is the transformation for high Q. So this is something that you might have studied in networks course. Please remember this. This is an important relationship to be understood in terms of Q of a coil. So let us therefore try to simulate an inductor L in series with the resistance R1, let us say. The same R1 is used for simulating it as Z equal to R1. Then impedance seen is R1 by 1 minus G. That you want it to be equal to R1 plus SL. L is again C into R1 into R2, because C R squared, that is the dimensional equivalence that we had got. So we can put this as C into R1 into R2. Then we get G equal to R1, R1 get cancelled, and G becomes equal to SC R2 by 1 plus SC R2, which represents a first order high pass filter. Please understand this. This represents a first order high pass filter. That is what you are going to put here, a first order high pass filter SCR2 by 1 plus SCR2, okay, is the G. Then in order to convert it into a voltage control voltage source, you put a buffer stage at the input and a buffer stage at the output. You get a voltage control voltage source with this kind of transfer function. And you put the Z, which is equal to R1, between the input and the output, and you get an equivalent which is just this. That is what we have just now shown. So R1 in series with SCR1 R2 is got by using this circuit. So this can be converted now into a special case. Now if you just put a short circuit between this and this, that means you get rid of this buffer, that results in this circuit. There is a special case of the previous circuit. Instead of using a buffer, then what happens? Just this R1 is going to load this low pass filter, that is all. So, that results in the equivalent at this corresponding to the DC resistance of R1 plus R2 to ground and the inductor that is simulated, which is SC R1 R2, that remains the same. The DC resistance instead of R1 now becomes R1 plus R2. You can prove this also by taking this circuit and evaluating the current through this R1 and show that this Vi by current through R1 is nothing but equivalent to R1 plus R2 in series with SC R1 R2. This is one of the famous circuits, okay, and this is never seen as an inductor simulator circuit. However, this is seen slightly differently. You consider that you have resistance from this point to ground of R1 plus R2, and you want this resistance not to shunt the input. So, what do? You connect this point, the junction between R1 and R2, to the output of this buffer stage, thereby shorting this for all high frequency utility. That means capacitor is acting as a short, okay, at any frequency of use of Vi. So, if the capacitance is acting as a short, R1 comes between this input and this output. Since G is equal to 1, okay, R1 appears as an infinite resistance. That means there is no current that is going to be drawn by R1. Okay, that means this combination of circuit does not load this input. This is called bootstrapping. This connection of this point to this output is called bootstrapping. So, this is one of the applications of this kind of inductor. You can treat it as an inductor getting simulated in series with R1 plus R2, and at the minimum frequency of interest, this is an open circuit compared to R1 plus R2. This is how you can design a bootstrapping circuit. It is primarily needed to provide a DC path for the bipolar transistor bias current to flow, DC current to flow to ground. However, it should not shunt the input. Okay. So, this bootstrapping helps it to simulate an inductor in series with R1 plus R2. This R2 is split into A and R2B for biasing it at a certain high voltage, so that there is a certain current passing through this. So, this circuit is very commonly used in single supply op amp structures, okay, where you want to provide from the input a DC path to ground, which should not shunt the input. Now, let us continue with our discussion on inductor simulation. We just said let that non-ideal inductor be an inductor in series with R1. Why should it be in series? It can be a non-ideal inductor with inductor in shunt with R1. So, R1 by 1 minus G should appear as R1, okay, parallel SL. Okay. So, it is nothing but, okay, 1 by 1 over R1 plus 1 over SC1 R2 R1. So, again R1 and R1 get cancelled and G comes out from this as minus 1 by SC R2. It is very important. What does it mean? It requires an integrator. You know this already as an integrator block. You convert the voltage to current here by putting an R2 to the inverting terminal, ground this. This is virtual ground. So, current in this is Vi by R2, and that flows through the capacitor and develops a voltage which is plus minus. So, you get a voltage minus Vi by SC R2. This we had discussed earlier in integrator. You put a buffer state there, it prevents the loading of input by R2. So we have a voltage control voltage source with this kind of transfer function. Now you put an R1 between its input and output, you get the inductor simulated with parallel resistance R1. That's all. That means you see that an ideal inductor is sufficient to simulate an inductor, ideal integrator. Now if you remove the buffer state just like we did before, that means you connect this to this, this you remove, then R2 will send that combination. So we have R1 parallel R2 with the buffer removed with the same inductor C, which is C R1 R2. So this is another circuit using single op amp, just like the bootstrapping circuit, which can simulate a non-ideal inductor, but resistance will be in parallel with the inductor. This is a very simple circuit, okay, using an integrator as the block to simulate a non-ideal inductor. Let us now move over to simulation of ideal inductor. How is it going to be possible? So we again do the same thing. R1 by 1 minus G, the Zin is going to be equated to ideal inductor SL, which is SC R1 R2. So R1 R1 get cancelled, G becomes equal to 1 minus unity gain and an integration, inverting integration, minus 1 by SC R2. So that is what we have to simulate. We have the need for the integrator, so the integrator block remains the same. However, we want to add the input voltage Vi to it. If you put just a buffer stage, this Vi comes here, this is grounded, and therefore it gives you just the integration, minus 1 by SCR2. That should be an input component directly from the input voltage appearing at the output. So how can you do that? We have to have a current in the integrator, which is Vi by R2. So we will lift this output to 2 Vi. So that this is still Vi, these two are equal resistances. So this is R and R, this will be 2 Vi, because this is Vi, this is Vi, Vi by R flows here, and the same current flows through this and develops a voltage 2 Vi. This Vi can be connected here. So this Vi becomes now available to you at the output, and addition to this drop, which is through the current, same current Vi by R2, still flows through there and develops a voltage which is minus 1 by SCR2 into Vi. So the voltage here is this Vi minus Vi by SCR2, which is what is wanted by us. So through this inductor now the current flows, which is Vi minus Vi, so Vi Vi get cancelled, plus Vi by SCR2 divided by R1. So it is Vi by SCR2 by R1, which is an inductive current, ideal inductor. So ideal inductor gets simulated. This circuit is known as a circuit that simulates an inductor connecting a capacitor at a port, is called a gyrator. Gyrator means rotation, okay. Gyration means rotation. So the phase shift, okay, between voltage and current changes by 180 degrees in order to make it get converted from capacitive current to inductive current. That is what is meant by gyration. So we have the ideal inductor that gets simulated this way. Let us therefore design, for example, a band pass filter, a second order band pass filter with center frequency equal to 5 kilohertz and a bandwidth of 1 kilohertz. Okay. This kind of design we had already seen how it can be done with R, C and L in shunt. So, we have seen that this can simulate a second order filter. So, what will be the transfer function? If this is R, this is C and L, we can see that the transfer function is 1 over R divided by 1 over R total admittance S C plus 1 over S L. Total admittance connected here and the admittance linking input to output at the numerator, which is nothing but multiplying by SL by R, okay, S squared LC plus SL by R plus 1, that is the band pass. It resonates at this frequency, this is nothing but written as S by omega naught Q, S squared by omega naught squared plus S by omega naught Q plus 1. So, Q is equal to R by root L by C, which is said to be equal to 5 in this. 5 kilohertz with 1 kilohertz bandwidth will mean 5 by 1, which is 5, that is called quality factor of the band pass filter. R, that is equal to R by root L by C, this we had seen in the passive filters class. So, that is equal to 5 and omega naught, which is 1 over root LC, that is equal to 2 pi into 5 kilohertz. So, from this we can evaluate the for C equal to 0.1 microfarad, R it comes out as 1590, L for resonance is 9.87 millihenries. This is what we have to simulate using the Gerator circuit, that is what has been done. So, L equal to C R1 R2 is 9.87 millihenries, R1 equal to R2 we have taken and that comes out as, okay, 314 ohms, okay. So, putting that value of the induct component 1590.1 microfarad, 314 ohms and 0.1 microfarad, one gets this simulation result. It is seen that the center frequency is exactly equal to 5 kilohertz, 5.008 it is giving, and bandwidth is coming out to be 1 kilohertz. So, this is the state of affairs as far as the simulated inductor is concerned. We have, please note that output is taken instead of here at this point. This difference is it has a gain of 2 apart from what we had written here. That means, the if you take the output at the op amp, first op amp output, it will be twice this input. So, this output is going to be actually twice S by omega naught Q divided by 1 plus S by omega naught Q plus S squared by omega naught squared. That means, when it resonates at omega naught, the output will be equal to input here, but output will in this output will be twice this input. So, you get a gain of 2, that is what is seen in the simulation also. This particular point, it is going to be 2.2, it is shown as 2.133, this is the effect of the gain bandwidth product of the op amp that we will see later. That means it is different from what we have designed it for, because the Q has got enhanced because of the gain bandwidth product. The transient response of this, even for large signal, you can see that it is going to be a band pass filter. So, whatever impulse that is applied here, okay, that is going to cause ringing. And as pointed out earlier in our passive filter design lectures, the Q is equivalent to count the number of peaks, go from this peak to 1/10 of that value. So, we have gone from this to 1/10 of its value, and the number of such peaks that you get equal to Q. So, we get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So, it tallies with whatever design we have carried out. Now, we have increased that series resistance here from 1590 to twice its value, okay. So, 3180. So, we get double the Q. That means, Q is going to be 10. So, Q of 10, 3180 is the resistance used in series. So, it has been doubled. That means, Q gets doubled 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Going from VP to 1/10 VP. Now, increasing Q by negative resistance, we can enhance the Q of such a circuit further by negative resistance simulation. This indicating a basic principle of simulating whatever you want. Negative resistance, we have simulated inductor. The Q is limited by this series resistance. Let us now enhance the Q by simulating a negative resistance across the inductor. This is Vi and this is 2Vi. So, the moment you put a resistance R shunt, what happens? Again, same Miller theorem is applicable at the input. So, we have Zin shunted by another Zin dash, let us say. Zin of the inductor is shunted by Zin dash, which is now another resistance connected to the input amplifier, input and output are shunt divided by 1 minus 2, which is minus R shunt. That any resistance that is connected to the gain of 2 amplifier between its input and output appears as a negative resistance. That means, the inductor is shunted by R shunt, which is negative. So, that can compensate for this positive resistance and result in an ideal tank circuit. What is an ideal tank circuit? It is nothing but an oscillator. So, this we will again use in synthesis of oscillators later, but now we are actually using it for enhancing the Q of an inductor. That means, the shunting effect should be such that the effective parallel resistance, which is R shunted by minus R shunt, okay, which is nothing but, let us see, R into minus R shunt divided by R minus R shunt, which is actually the Zin dash, which is R shunt divided by R shunt minus R. As long as R shunt is okay greater than R, it is still positive and therefore it is finite Q. Okay. So, it is can be used as a filter with enhanced Q. Now, I am demonstrating it by making Rp equal to 3180 is the resistance that we had put earlier in series, this one. So, that can be compensated for by putting a negative resistance, which is just slightly lower than this R. That means, it is going to be effectively negative. That means a transient response of that will be exponentially increasing without even any input. Therefore, the output will be the at frequency of naught, okay, which is 1 over 2 pi root LC, which is in this case 1 over 2 pi RC. So, it will f naught 2 pi RC becomes an oscillator with unlimited amplitude. That is why as far as this op amp is concerned, it is a 741 op amp biased at okay plus minus 15 volts, and therefore it goes all the way up to about 12 to 13 volts and gets chopped off, distortion sets in, okay. So, that means it is exponentially increasing now. This is the transient response. If you just further decrease the value of negative resistance, then it goes into increased amplitude of oscillation, and we are increasing the frequency by changing C 2.01 micro farad and with a gain bandwidth product of 741 being at 1 megahertz, it now goes into limitation by this slew rate. It tries to oscillate, but the rate of rise demanded is too much, okay, for it to oscillate at this frequency, which is f naught equal to 1 over 2 pi RC, and therefore it goes into what is called oscillation limited by, both in amplitude and frequency, limited by the maximum rate at which output of the op amp can rise, that is 1 volt per microsecond, and not by saturation. This just I want you to make a note of, that you can't therefore design any filter that you desire, okay, with any value of Q, okay, that is very high. It might go into instability because of the effect of, we will see, the gain bandwidth product or finite gain bandwidth product of the op amp and the slew rate. So, this is the topic that we have to discuss now, effect of active device parameter. That is the most fundamental limitation of active filters, right. Simulated inductance is influenced by the parameters DC gain of the op amp. If it is a transistor, it is the DC gain of the transistor amplifier, and the gain bandwidth product GB of the op amp. Again, if it is a transistor, it is the FT of the transistor, MOSFET or bipolar, that comes into picture. That will limit the performance of the inductor that gets simulated using these active devices. So, it means it is sensitive to the active device parameters like finite DC gain and finite gain bandwidth product. Out of this, I want to show you that as far as op amp is concerned, it is the finite gain bandwidth product which is ultimately the deciding factor regarding how high a frequency this component will work as a simulated inductor. Guided circuit uses non-inverting amplifier of gain 2 here, as we have seen, and an integrator, okay, which is going to give you a transfer function of minus 1 by SCR, okay. So, from here it is going to be 1 plus 1 over SCR, okay, with half the voltage coming into picture or VI coming into picture. So, G is equal to 1 minus omega naught by S is the ideal transfer function of this gyrator block from here to here. Now, what happens? Let us analyze. G changes. That effect of change in G because of the gain of 2 amplifier in the front end and cascaded to an integrator next, is to change that we have seen already, that as far as the first stage is concerned, it is going to be 1 by 1 plus, okay, 1 over loop gain. So, that loop gain is A by 2 as far as the buffer stage is concerned. The next one is the integrator, that is whatever integration it does, minus omega naught by S divided by 1 plus again 1 over loop gain, which is this we had already done in discussion on amplifiers. So, 1 over loop gain now becomes for the integrator 1 plus omega naught by S divided by A. So, this can be approximated as 1 minus omega naught by S into 1 minus 2 by A plus 1 by A, which is 3 by A minus omega naught by S A. That is the first order effect on the gain. That is why it is approximately equal to this. The full effect is 1 into this 1 minus 3 by A minus omega naught by S A. The minus omega naught by S gets modified as 1 minus 3 by A minus omega naught by S A. So, if you now observe the effect of this on the gain, this is equal to 1 minus omega naught by S minus omega naught by S A plus 3 omega naught by S A plus omega naught squared by S squared A, full effect. Now, taking the real part and the part that is controlled by S separately, the 1 changes to 1 minus omega naught squared by omega naught squared, okay. So, this is the part omega S equal to j omega is what is put. We are investigating the whole thing primarily at the resonant frequency. So, we are interested in the effect of the gain bandwidth product and the gain on G. So, effect of G is seen here as, okay, S equal to j omega naught is what is substituted. So, S squared becomes minus omega naught squared. So, this brings in 1 by A naught minus 1 by A naught here, and omega naught by S into 1 plus 1 over A naught minus 3 over A naught. So, this is the effect on the inductor that is simulated. Whatever is the coefficient of S affects the inductor value, and this real part affects the resistive part that is getting shunted to the inductor that is simulated. So, you can now do R by 1 minus G, okay, G being replaced by this. Then you get this as R by 1 by A naught. When A naught is infinity, this goes to 0. That means this is a resistance shunting the inductor, and the magnitude of the resistance shunting the inductor is A naught into R. And the inductor, okay, which is 1 by SL, okay, L is equal to R by omega naught originally. Omega naught is 1 over CR. So, that is why L was equal to CR square. That gets modified as 1 minus 2 by A naught. The inductor value, okay, just slightly increases because of finite gain, okay, the frequency of resonance shifts down. That is of not much concern. What is of concern is that the Q of the inductor becomes limited by the finite DC gain because of the shunting. Q is going to be equal to A naught. So, instead of infinity, Q is going to be equal to A naught, L is going to be R by omega naught dash. That is what happens. This is the modification due to finite gain. Inductance is shunted by a negative, a positive resistance R into A naught, okay. And the inductor value is going to be slightly enhanced because of the finite gain, okay. Now let us look at the effect of finite gain bandwidth product. Effect of finite gain is that inductor is shunted by R A naught, that means Q is changing to A naught, Q of the system is A naught. And inductor value is slightly increased. Now we see the effect of, let us see, gain bandwidth product. So instead of A equal to A naught, you now substitute A equal to GB by S in the same expression for G. So when you substitute A equal to GB by S, we see that original 1 minus omega naught by S changes to minus S by GB, okay, that is still frequency dependent, okay, capacitor actually. The inductor gets shunted by a capacitor and the gain increases to 1 plus 2 omega naught by GB. When you put A equal to GB by S and S equal to J omega naught, this is what happens, okay. This becomes minus omega naught squared, okay. So this becomes minus 1, this is GB by S. So 1 minus GB by S, that becomes, and this is going to be 2 omega naught by SA, which is GB by S, which is 2 omega naught by GB. So it is going to be that if you now substitute R by 1 minus G as the whole thing, R by 1 minus G and with G as this value, you will see that this will be R divided by, okay, 1 1 gets cancelled, this will be omega naught by S, okay, by R, okay, plus S by GB R, okay, minus 2 omega naught by so let me write that here equals one by omega naught by S R, that is the inductor, okay, it is slightly changed because of the effect of this S by GB R capacity effect, then minus 2 omega naught divided by GB into R, that is the negative resistance, okay. This is, so apart from the positive resistance, you have a negative resistance which is R GB by 2 omega naught in shunt with the inductance. There was a positive resistance of R A naught, okay, and that effect is due to finite gain, okay. So we had the positive resistance there, now that is going to be further changed, okay. So that is 1 by R A naught. Apart from that, we have a negative resistance due to the finite gain bandwidth product. So that is the equivalent circuit that we see ultimately for the whole effect of A naught as well as finite gain bandwidth product of the inductor that is simulated. Let us therefore look at the whole thing. So band pass filter with simulated inductance C equal to 0.1 microfarad, R equal to 1 kilo ohm, V naught over VI equal to 1, okay. So we have seen that this, the gain changes, actually what happens, the gain also changes because of the effect of Q changing. So what is the gain change, it is the same as that is happening, okay, due to Q change. So let us look at the gain change. So it is 2 divided by 1 minus, we will see, due to the Q actual changing to omega naught divided by negative resistance, which is corresponding to this. Apart from R, okay, into A naught due to finite, what is that, DC gain of the op amp, we have a negative resistance which is RGB by omega naught shunting that. So the actual Q changes to, okay, this value and changing the gain at the center by this amount, 2Q omega naught by GB. This is what happens. So let us consolidate the whole thing. Earlier the Q was decided by the DC gain. So it was R 1 over R into A naught, okay, that was the Q. Now because of the negative resistance, Q changes to minus GBR by 2 omega naught. This is the negative resistance, this is the positive resistance, okay, effect. So the Q was actually controlled by R, right. So that is coming in shunt. So that R, actually earlier the Q was this, okay, Q actual was this, right, it is now changing to this. Let us therefore define the Q determined by R A naught as Q. Then you can see that it is going to be Q due to finite gain bandwidth product is equal to 1 over Q minus 2 omega naught by GB. So we have this becoming equal to Q by 1 minus 2 omega naught Q divided by G. So if you say that you have an effective Q determined by this, this is the capacitor C, this is the inductor C R square. Because of the negative resistance coming across this, which is G B R divided by 2 omega naught, the effect of Q is Q enhancement takes place due to the finite gain bandwidth product. That is what changes the gain also by the amount, small amount, 1.035 at the input, that times 2 is the actual gain at the output of the op amp. So we have purposely increased the Q to 100. And the negative resistance remains the same. The gain changes now from 1 to 1.47 by calculation if you use the enhancement method, and it is simulation is giving 1.516. So it is closely approximated, okay, to whatever we have actually theoretically evaluated as Q enhancement. And we make the thing oscillate by actually increasing the frequency further from, okay, 1.59 to 15.9 by increasing both the capacitors, decreasing both the capacitors by a factor of 10, frequency increases by a factor of 10. The circuit oscillates, negative resistance accumulated is 31.4 kilo ohm, positive resistance is 100 kilo ohm. There is nothing but R GB by 2 omega naught. F naught being equal to 15.9 kilohertz, GB being 1 megahertz, okay, with the same value of resistance R, you get a negative resistance simulated because of the finite gain Venter product as 31.4 kilo ohm, that is much less than 100 kilo ohm. So, it goes deep into slew rate mode of operation, just the same effect which we had seen earlier, okay. So, the slew rate limitation comes into picture, limiting the operational frequency due to slew rate, okay, which is 1 volt per microsecond in the case of operational amplifier 741. The amplitude also gets limited by slew rate, okay. This is the output, okay, across the so called simulated inductor. This is the output of the op amp, and you will see that it is violating at its input. This is at one terminal. This where did we observe all these effects? We have observed this effect, okay, at the inputs, two inputs. Actually, if it is working as an op amp, okay, at all times this voltage should be roughly equal to this voltage, whereas you see because of the slew rate limitation, right, this whole thing has got converted into these two voltages are different. The moment those two are different, the op amp is never considered as an annihilator, because its limitation has come into picture. These two voltages are becoming different. Output is always rising at slew rate, okay, and therefore input voltage is not zero, okay. Only at this point it is acting as an annihilator again. Again, it is trying its best to rise at maximum rate possible for it, and then again changing the sign here, okay. So, it is trying to follow the input point. So, this is expanded that to highlight the whole issue. Now, sensitivity of the actual Q to the gain Venter product can be illustrated by that. This Q is the one due to finite gain A naught, okay, finite DC gain, and that gets modified as 1 minus 2 omega naught Q by GB because of the negative resistance that comes about due to the finite gain bandwidth product. So, sensitivity of Q to GB is roughly equal to, if you differentiate this and see, it is minus 2 omega naught Q by GB itself. The higher the Q, higher is the sensitivity, okay. Sensitivity of omega naught by GB is, on the other hand, not so much. It does not depend upon the Q, it just depends upon the GB. It is pretty small. But if this Q is very high, okay, then the sensitivity of gain Venter product to Q also is very high. So, we cannot design high Q inductors, okay, using this kind of technique, unless we select the gain bandwidth product to be very, very high compared to F naught. So, this gives us the limitation due to the gain bandwidth product. So, this is summarized here. Q enhancement takes place due to the finite gain bandwidth product. Q actual is equal to Q due to the finite DC gain or the actual resistance that is put, across the inductor divided by 1 minus 2 omega naught q by Gb. Omega naught actual is equal to omega naught by 1 minus omega naught by Gb. This is omega naught active, q active. Sensitivity is too high for high Q structures, high Q inductors. So, this is the limitation. This limitation due to active parameter sensitivity comes about in simulated inductor. Unless we take care of proper selection of the gain bandwidth product of the op amp and the slew rate. So, these two fundamental limitations have to be borne in mind in the design of inductor for high frequency application. Now, coming to the generalized garator, we replace all the resistors by impedances. These are all resistors and this was capacitor and this was also resistor. So, replace these resistors by Z1, Z2, Z3, Z4, Z5. Then we can show that Zin equals, we can do that very simply. This gain from here to here is now 1 plus Z2 by Z1 times Vi. Okay. Then this is Vi itself. So, the current in this is Vi Z2 by Z1 divided by Z3. Vi get cancelled. So, that flows through this and this voltage is going to be Vi, this Vi minus Vi Z2 Z1 Z3 into Z4. So, and the current in this, therefore, Vi again gets cancelled, is going to be Vi Z2 Z4 by Z1 Z3 Z5 this. So, Zin seen is Z1 Z3 Z5 by Z2 Z4 and let us consider this circuit that we have already discussed, okay, with all the Z1 Z2 Z3 and Z5 replaced by R. And Z4 alone is 1 over SC, that is one inductor simulator. The next one we can have instead of that Z2 as capacitor and all the others as resistor and it simulates the same inductor. So, using one topology we can get two garator circuits. This way actually you can multiply the number of circuits, different circuits that can act as garators. So, in conclusion we say that garator simulation of the inductor, this is the grounded inductor simulation, is one of the ways of replacing RLC circuit where inductor is grounded by simulated inductors and getting the high Q required for the application of all types of filters. Okay. We have illustrated it by using a band pass filter. In the next class, we will see the other technique leading to some of the Salen and Key filters which are well known, that is negative feedback and positive feedback being utilized to enhance the Q.